Hey folks, my name is Nathan Johnston, and in today's video, we're continuing with our series on applications of linear systems, okay? So what we're going to do today is we're going to look at the problem of if I'm given a single matrix, how can I find all matrices that commute with it? In other words, if I'm given a matrix A, how can I find all matrices B with the property that A times B equals B times A? And remember, in general, matrix multiplication is not commutative. So like this is not true in general, but nonetheless, it is true for some special matrices, and that's what we want to find. And we're going to find it by setting this problem up as a linear system. So let's get into it. Okay, so suppose that we're given the matrix A, which is 1, 1, 1, negative 2, and we want to find all matrices that commute with it. Okay, so we want to find all matrices B with the property that A times B equals B times A. How can we do this? And what we're going to do is we're going to use our sledgehammer, right? We're going to use linear systems, which are the tool that solve all of our problems in linear algebra, okay? So what we're going to do is we're going to say, I don't know what matrix B is. Just give names to its entries. Call them A, B, C, and D. And then what you've got is you've got a system of equations. You've got A times B equals B times A, and just expand out. Figure out what A times B is. Figure out what B times A is. A times B, that's going to be A plus C in the top left corner, then B plus D in the top right corner, and then so on. You just do matrix multiplication to figure out what all four entries of that matrix are. And similarly, for B times A, well, you just multiply the matrices in the opposite order. And again, you get some expressions for the four entries of that matrix. Okay, and then what we want to happen is we want A times B to equals B times A, so we just set these two matrices equal to each other. And in particular, what that means is that all four of their entries have to be the same as each other. So for example, their top left entries have to be the same as each other, so that means A plus C has to equal A plus B. Okay, their top right entries also have to be equal to each other, so B plus D equals A minus 2b, and similarly for the other entries as well. Okay, so this gives us four equations, one for each of the four entries in the matrices in four variables, right? The variables are A, B, C, and D. It's a linear system, right? Nothing more complicated happens in any of these equations than just variable times scalar plus variable times scalar equals variable times scalar plus variable times scalar. Those are linear equations. So we can solve this just via moving everything over to the left-hand side, throwing it into a matrix, doing our row operations, and interpreting our row echelon form. And that's exactly what we're going to do. Maybe before we get into that, I will note that, hey, this linear system here, it is simple enough that you might be able to solve it directly. Like, for example, that top equation there, A plus C equals A plus B, you might just notice that I can cancel the A's on both sides. I'm just going to get C equals B, and then you can substitute that into the other equations and sort of whittle it down. So if you want to solve it directly, that's fine, but I'm going to sort of do it our standardized way of set it up as a linear system, throw it into a matrix, do row operations, and then interpret at the end of the day. All right, so that's what I'm going to do. When I throw it into a matrix, remember, every one of the rows of the matrix corresponds to an equation in our linear system, and every one of the columns tells me the coefficients of one of the variables in the linear system. So for example, that first column there, which is 0, negative 1, 1, 0, tells me that in the equations up above, the coefficients of A, the first variable, are 0, then negative 1, then 1, then 0. And similarly for the other columns, which represent the variables B, C, and D. Okay, and now that we've got it in this augmented matrix form, we just draw our row operations. Okay, I'm going to go all the way to reduced row echelon form. So the way I'm going to do that is first, I'm going to swap rows 1 and row 3. And when that happens, yay, now I've got a leading entry in the top left corner, right? And that leading entry is 1 even, which is even better. Okay, next up, I don't like that negative 1 below the 1 that's at the top left corner. So I'm just going to add row 1 to row 2, which is going to fix up that first column and turn it into just 1, 0, 0, 0. And then I'm happy with that first column. Next, let's clean up that second column. Okay, it's got three leading entries in it. I don't like that. I want a leading entry in the 2, 2 entry, but nothing below it. I'm going to turn that leading entry in the 2, 2 entry into a 1 just by swapping rows 2 and 4. Okay, and then I'm going to clear out the other leading entries below it by adding row 2 to row 3 and subtracting triple row 2 from row 4, right? And I'll turn the negative 1 and the 3 down below it into zeros. And then, hey, at this point, now I'm in reduced row echelon form, right? I've got two leading entries in sort of the standard diagonal pattern. All the zero rows are tucked away at the bottom. All my leading entries are 1, and both above and below my leading entries, I've got all zeros. So this is reduced row echelon form. From here, I'm going to be able to figure out all of the solutions to my linear system. And the way I interpret this is, again, remember, where are my leading entries? Well, they're in the A and B columns. So A and B are my leading variables. C and D, those columns, they don't have any leading variables in them. So C and D are free. Okay, so what I do is I solve for my leading variables in terms of the free variables. Remember that top row of the matrix there that corresponds to the equation 1 times A plus 0 times B minus 3 times C minus D equals 0. Okay, and you can rearrange that to get leading variable in terms of free variables. So A in terms of C and D. Okay, and similarly, that second row of that matrix, that tells me that 1 times B minus 1 times C equals 0. So just rearrange that B equals C. Leading variable equals what in terms of the free variables? And then I just throw this all back into the original matrix that I was trying to solve for. Remember, the matrix that I'm trying to solve for is B, which had entries A, B, C, and D in it. And well, okay, C and D, the bottom two entries of the matrix, those are free. They can be anything they want to be. But once you know those bottom two entries, you can figure out what the top two entries have to be. And in particular, I just learned up above that A equals 3C plus D. So that's what the top left entry is. And I also just learned that B equals C. So that's what the top right entry is. Okay. And the point is, every single matrix that commutes with A, it has this form for some choice of C and D. Okay, and if the question wasn't particularly specific about what your final answer should look like, this is a fine final answer right now. Okay, maybe add on a little half sentence after the fact saying, oh, and C and D can be anything, they're free. Okay, we're going to go one step farther because there's another really nice way to think about this. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to factor out the C and D. And when I do that, I just ask myself, how many C's are there in each entry? And there's 3 in the top left, 1 in the 2 off diagonals, and 0 in the bottom right. So it's C times 3110. And then how many D's are there in each entry? Well, just 1 along the diagonal and 0 is off diagonal. So plus D times 1001. Okay. And so one way of thinking about this is the matrices that commute with A, they're exactly the linear combinations of these two special matrices here. The second one is the identity matrix, and the first one is the special matrix 3110. And then all linear combinations also commute with A. And actually, if we work just slightly harder, if we just sort of tweak the variables a little bit, write this as C times 111 minus 2 plus 2C plus D times the identity matrix. This is a valid decomposition as well. I've just sort of shifted some of the weight over to that second matrix in the linear combination. Then this is even nicer because now that first matrix, the one that's multiplying C there, that 111 negative 2, that's actually A itself. Okay, so what this is saying is the matrices that commute with A are, well, A itself and the identity and all their linear combinations. And if you think about that, you could have figured out that answer right from like the very first second we saw this question. It doesn't even really depend on A, right? If I give you any matrix A and say, what matrices commute with it? You could say right away, like this is true for every matrix, A commutes with itself and the identity matrix commutes with A as well. And also if two matrices commute with A, then any linear combination of them commutes with A as well. The only thing that we didn't know before solving the linear system were that these were the only matrices that commute with A. In other words, like right from the get-go, we should have known that there were going to be at least two free variables when we solved this linear system, one corresponding to A and one corresponding to the identity matrix. Okay. And when we solved that linear system and found that, hey, there are only two free variables, like that's it, then we could just be done. We know that the linear combinations of A itself and the identity matrix, those are the only ones that commute with A. All right, that's all I've got for you today. Thanks for watching, everyone. We've still got a boatload of more of these videos that we're going to do, other neat things that you can do with linear systems. We'll get to those over the coming weeks. Have a good one.